Hello and welcome along to Match Day 12 of the World Game live here at SBS. I'm your host Lucy Zelic. It's fabulous to have your company as always, as it is the gentleman to my left here. Welcome to you, Nick Stoll, aka Stollich.
Hey, how are you, Lucy?
It's
some big news.
Yeah, there is some big news and some great news actually. Corey and I, we're having a baby. So it's already been ousted thanks to my wonderful colleague Craig Foster on air on Saturday. So that was lovely. And he put up a really very kind tweet for us. Yep. We're both over the moon.
Yeah, well, congratulations from everyone here.
Everyone's
super excited
And, yeah, it's a super exciting time. So we get to extend the family and invite another Liverpool supporter into the world.
Yeah,
so that
can
only be a good thing, right?
Yes, I think we're all looking forward to see with the Zelic and Gamiro combination what kind of football ability you guys
we're hoping it's a decent football ability. Our plan is for the child to play Champions League football at the very least,
and in a World Cup.
I want to be able to witness that. We want to be able to witness that in our time. I don't think that's unreasonable.
There's big expectations on what is a fetus. Let's be honest right now. We were talking about the ultimate, that situation is, of course, in Manchester at the moment. You have Sergio Aguero's son, Benjamin, who Sergio Aguero's partner, who he had that child with, was Diego Maradona's daughter. So you've got Maradona, Aguero.
We all know why he did that, right?
Yeah, of course.
Aguero's not stupid.
Man, he's setting up his retirement with that lineage. Just go, yeah, don't worry about it. I got a kid who's going to make billions. Anyway, so, and then just for the kicker, is Messi is the godfather of that kid. So I think he's like 6 years old now. You know, he's at the Man City Academy. I'm sure he's going to be good.
Well,
but maybe the Zelic Gamiro.
Well, look, we're hoping that with our footballing genetics that it manages to, to live up to expectations and that, as I said, our child does play Champions League and World Cup football.
Yeah, 100%.
But you know what? All you want for, and a lot of parents out there will understand, this is a healthy baby. So I want to just thank everybody too that does know the news, that's reached out over social media and congratulated us. Thank you. It's really touching and it's really nice. It's a nice time for us. To be creating our own little family, and it's a nice thing to share with the football family too. So thank you to everybody. Before we get into everything, we always like to address what we're wearing here on the World Game Lives. If you are joining us via Twitter, can I stress to you the importance of using the hashtag SBSTheWorldGame when you do write into us with your questions, and Stolich and I will do our very best to get to them. For those of you joining us via Facebook, rules are, as always, just write your question in and Stolich and I will get to them. But what are we wearing today? What have you got?
Well, I am wearing a shirt from the football cult Johnny Warren fans community. It is from the 1971 game between St. George Budapest, and I think they played Japan and Japan B. So really cool t-shirt. I think our Anthony Siokas runs it all.
Correct.
It's got like Johnny Warren's name on it. Really cool t-shirt. You can go check it out at that website.
Yeah, and I'm glad you said that because you're doing the work for me. I also am wearing a football cult t-shirt today for World Soccer. We know that our great Les Murray was a part of that program alongside Johnny Warren many, many years ago. So it's a fantastic tribute to him because today would have been Les's 73rd birthday, the 5th of November, and Johnny passed on the 6th of November all those years ago. So happy birthday, Maestro. The world is not the same without you, but we know that heaven is better off for having you in it. So it's a good day, but it's also a tough day because we still miss Les every day.
Yeah. Stolich? And I think his like impact reverberates around the building at all kind of times, just not even whether the shirts we wear, or obviously we've got his poster up here, but just, you know, in the culture that he built here. And I think the love of football and things like getting involved in the Copa Libertadores, which you've done, and now such a massive Super Classico final that we're going to have, that's something that Les would 100% be always pushing. South American football.
Yep.
You know, a few years ago, I got the chance to play in a kind of charity tournament, actually the Les Murray Cup, they called it, and we played in Gremio shirts, and Gremio played obviously against River, which is an amazing game. Referee getting surrounded by police at the end. Absolutely, never seen such scenes, but Les's legacy definitely lives on every single day.
No, it certainly does. Very well said, Stolich. So salute to you in heaven, Les Murray, our great dear friend. We miss you every day. Let's talk about the football now, and let's get into the Premier League overnight. And first of all, I want to address Manchester City's absolute belting of Southampton, 6-1. They have now well and truly claimed top spot on the ladder. Is anyone or anything going to stop this club from going back-to-back this year, Stolich?
They look better than they did last season.
Is the Pep effect, isn't it? He loves to evolve the team and make them better every year.
I mean, that's it. They've got 100 points and they might be better. So the thing is right now is that Liverpool are keeping pace with them. Tottenham is keeping pace with them. Chelsea is keeping pace with them. But you just think, like, they look so ridiculously strong. They don't just win. They've been 6-1. I think under Pep in the last two seasons, they've won by 5+ goals or scored 5+ goals about 11, 12 times. You know, Aguero scored his 150th goal. Sterling's stupid. In form. I think Bernardo Silva has been brilliant for them, and I would have thought he was more of a fringe player last season. So they haven't had De Bruyne, who was their best player last season.
Injured again.
But it doesn't even look like it stops them at this stage. So for me, they're clearly the favourites to win. The big, big test, and we know this, as much as they obviously are concentrating on the league right now, is the Champions League.
Mm-hmm.
That will be the big litmus test. And listen, for me, Pep Guardiola is the best coach in the world, but I think he needs to win the Champions League with City or at least go to a semi-final.
Did you see his comments that came out? I think it was last week or even a little bit earlier on than that, in which he said he doesn't feel that the club is ready to win the Champions League yet because there's not enough of the push from the fans.
Yeah.
There's not enough of a demand from them. What do you think about those comments?
It's got to be mind games. I mean, obviously, like, you know, he's trying to
get... You have to keep this group motivated.
Yeah, that's what I think. Like, they're smashing ever. So, yeah. Like, they're just... He doesn't want them to take the foot off the gas. And we saw in that kind of that Amazon documentary how intense he is, even when they were extremely far ahead in the league. So I think that's part of it. I think the fans have a weird relationship with the Champions League. They don't always fill out the ground. They sometimes boo the anthem. You know, I think historically they have some issues there. I don't particularly understand it because, for me, the Champions League is still... I know some people say that to win the league is the more representative of
I'd
who was the best
I'd rather win the Champos.
Yeah, I think everyone would.
Like, would you too?
Yeah, I say that as a...
Facebookers, Twitter users, what would you rather win, the domestic title or the Champions League trophy?
It's the Champions League. I mean, it's like the music plays, you know, the spine tingles. Like, it is the Champions League. You definitely want to win it. And, you know, if they win the league by 100 points and they go out in the quarterfinals like they did last season...
Mm-hmm.
I think there'll still be a lot of kind of, he just didn't do it in the Champions League.
Because who could stop them in the Champions League, do you feel? I mean, I know that Liverpool, and I'm not saying that biasly because I'm a Red supporter, they did actually put the nail in the coffin to them last season in the Champions League, both domestically. I think it was a win apiece for them, but then in Europe it was a different story.
I mean, you'd say, listen, Barca, full strength, always dangerous, you know, can destroy anyone. Juve, very strong at the moment. Madrid, I mean, they've won it 3 times in a row. You know, they look absolutely terrible, by the way. Ciao, Lopetegui. Thanks for keeping my job. Absolutely.
It literally happened the day after you said it. He goes, and for those of you only joining us on this particular program, last week, we'll give you the update. Stolic did say that Lopetegui will be sacked within the week. And this was after the massive loss in the El Clasico. And he said, if he's not sacked within the week, I'm going to offer my resignation.
No resignation.
So I kept going off of a bit of, you know, past history, which was that Benitez didn't get sacked straight after the Super Clasico. And then he managed to survive a little bit longer before he then got the punt. Whereas you've survived, Lopetegui did not.
Nope.
Who then is the job going to go to? That's the question. Because Mauricio Pochettino is being tipped as a potential front runner.
I mean, how do they get him away from Tottenham, though? You know, because Levy's going to hold on to him for everything. I think Pochettino wants to go.
You think?
Yeah, you know, you hear him complaining a bit, saying he's unhappy, the performances haven't been great, he hasn't been getting the investment he wants.
Yeah, but no wonder he's unhappy. His players are unhappy too. Yeah. They're dropping like flies because of injury. They didn't create any depth and buy in the summer transfer window. The stadium is still being delayed. Levy's a bit of a tight ass. I get it. He spent a lot of money investing in the stadium and then also, you know, giving these players, star players, mind you, big, big long-term contracts. So the purse strings are a bit tight, but then what do you expect? Of course Poch is going to be unhappy.
And how often does Real Madrid come around? Because, you know, maybe they go with someone else and then that person does really well and then Tottenham start to decline a little bit, which is, you know, natural after a certain amount of time.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe the opportunity goes. Mm. So you kind of need to ride the wave that you're on.
Yeah.
So, I don't know, I think there's been talk of Conte. It seems Ramos kind of spoke for the players and said, we don't want that kind of manager at the club. We, you know, the manager should earn the respect of the players, that kind of thing.
How do you feel about Ramos saying that, though? You're a player. You don't get a choice who comes to the club, all right? You need to start respecting who's in the position.
Yeah. So I think that's the thing. But that's the thing at Real Madrid. The players are super powerful. And he did make the point that the coaches that have done the best at Real Madrid have been the kind of not so imposing hard men. They've been Ancelotti, who gets on very well with his players. They've been Zidane, who's very good at managing the group. They've been Del Bosque, who again, maybe they're not so tactically brilliant, but they are very good at keeping a talented group extremely happy and working towards the collective
goal. Where's Bielsa?
Bielsa is top of the championship with Leeds.
Yeah,
and
but
they are looking good.
But where is he when you need him for a situation like this?
He's not going to work at Real Madrid. Can you imagine him, all his pressing, all his craziness, Ramos, you got to watch 9 hours of video.
That's what I love about it. That's what I love about it.
No, it's not going to happen. So Bielsa, no, it's not going to happen. Even he is too crazy for Real Madrid, and they don't mind a few nutters there. But anyway, I mean, Real Madrid, Solari is the interim coach, and maybe he'll be okay, but...
No, they're not going to give it to the assistant coach. Christopher Martin via Facebook, good day to you. Conte seems their easiest option. One Serie A and Prem builds good teams. With the cash of Madrid, he could build the team he wanted at Chelsea. Thoughts, Stolich?
Well, I mean, here's the thing with Real Madrid. It's like, you know, do you risk putting offside all these players?
Mm-hmm.
Like Ramos, like the Modric, all these kind of players. Because Conte is going to do that. But maybe it's time. They've been on the decline.
But is he going to do that? He doesn't actually have a right to do that. This is the thing about the players wielding too much power in this scenario. They probably need a coach like that.
Yeah.
Someone that's going to come in, that's going to be disciplined. And I know that a lot of the players, whilst Conte was at Chelsea, spoke about how laborious his training sessions and how repetitive and boring they could be because it was just a lot of the same patterns of play.
Double sessions.
Double sessions, just playing against mannequins, all of that to get the structure and the shape right. Well, guess what? It won him a title.
Yeah.
So I think that, you know, he does already come with good pedigree. He could be, you know, somebody that could garner a dressing room and get the job done. But
well, another thing that's potentially impacting it is that Real Madrid want to bring in Eden Hazard.
Yeah.
But Eden Hazard does not want to play with Conte again.
Which went bad, of course, we
so
all know.
Yeah, so there is this thing of, like, Real Madrid are in a bit of a predicament. You know, we say Pochettino's not available.
Yeah.
Conte might have issues with the players.
Here's a suggestion for you while you're going through that. Dan Midian via Facebook, good afternoon to you. Wenger to Madrid. That's another name that's been bandied about.
Yeah. No, it's not going to happen. What, like, what? This guy came, like, fourth, fifth, missed out on Champions League with Arsenal. It's not going to happen. They're better off going for, I think, like, a young Spanish coach. So I think the
coach. That's not going to happen, though. Not for a club of Madrid's quality and their stature. They want a big name coach, but the problem is they don't have too many options. So it'll be interesting to see how that plays out, to be fair.
They did get very lucky on the weekend, winning 2-0. And Vinicius Jr., the 18-year-old that they paid 45 million euros for, the Brazilian, when he was 16, came on 20 minutes, set up the first goal, caused no goal. So, you know, and one of the problems apparently for Lopetegui was that he wasn't playing Vinicius. He didn't think he was ready.
Yep.
And now
look at what he does when he comes on.
And Florentino was saying, we spent 45 million on this kid. You play him. You develop him. You get him going. So, I don't know. We'll see. You know, they're winning again. You know, they've got to play obviously Champions League during the week. So, I'm not sure. But, yeah, well, interesting times ahead for Madrid.
How about Barca smashing the bejesus out of Rayo Vallecano?
Yeah. I mean, well, to be honest, they kind of got lucky. It was a 3-2, last-minute goal. Suarez... looking good again, you know, like he's really stepping up. Sometimes I think, you know, Suarez has to be Messi's Robin to his Batman, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And I think Suarez much more thrives, actually, when he is the leader, when he is the Batman. We saw him at Liverpool when he was at his absolute peak.
Yep.
He had, like, Sterling next to him and Sturridge. And it was just, but it was just that thing of, like, a very young Sterling, an inconsistent, like, Sturridge with injury and all that kind of stuff. And he just took it. He was winning games by himself. It was one of the most dominant individual performances I've ever seen in the Premier League. So I think he's thriving without Messi, although Messi is back in the squad, apparently, to face Inter, barring medical clearance. So
Christopher Martin, going back to the whole conversation around Real, Bayern going for a young coach in Kovac isn't working too well for them. What makes a young Spanish coach at Real any different? Good question. Look at what's happened to Bayern. I'm so pleased because Dortmund are sitting on top of the table, 4 points clear of the second place, Borussia Mönchengladbach. But Bayern in third.
Mm-hmm.
I think that, you know, fans of the Bundesliga in Germany, they're already getting sick of it. The fact that Bayern come in every year and continue to towel it up has made it for a very uninteresting season for them year in, year out. But where their real failure is coming from is in Europe for Bayern. That seems to be the problem. I don't have high hopes for them in the Champions League this season, to be fair.
Really.
And I haven't for a number of years. I mean, when was it? Was it last time, 2012? They won the title?
2013, they beat Dortmund.
Yeah, 2012-13.
Yeah.
It was a painful one for me to remember as well. But that said, it's a good point because for big clubs like this, I don't know that giving a young coach a big opportunity is the right way to go.
Well, yeah.
As Christopher Martin says.
The thing as well is, like, we have such high turnover of coaches now. Coaches seem to get fired a lot more easier. So you're actually running out of coaches that you can kind of go through, you know what I mean? They don't stay very long, and I don't know. It'll be interesting to see what's going on.
What happens to Lopetegui now, by the way?
I mean, Lopetegui couldn't even get a job in the A-League at the moment. Lopetegui is stinking.
Oh, I think Lopetegui, he could get a job in the A-League. Come on, let's Lopetegui be fair. Stats.
He was there 138 days, right?
Yeah.
Played 14 matches. He lost six times. This is Real Madrid we're talking about, the three times Champions League winners in a row. They once went, for a while, they went 8 hours without scoring a goal. 8 hours, Real Madrid. 8 hours. They have Bale, Benzema, Asensio, Isco, Modric. 8 hours without scoring a goal.
Yeah, but don't forget they also lost their most prolific goal scorer in Cristiano Ronaldo. That's a big hole to fill,
yeah,
right?
Okay, but 8 hours?
Yeah, okay, I agree with you. I didn't buy into that whole theory that no Ronaldo, no party. Very early on when they started to kind of fall off the wayside, I thought, hang on, let's pump the brakes a bit. We're getting a bit too cack-a-doodle. It's only been a short time, but it's a big, big hole to fill. I really think it's very difficult.
And they will have to. But there's another thing. Where are the really top number nines? So who do you go for? Lewandowski?
That's true. That's true.
You know, I think Firmino's a great player, but he's not exactly the number nine. Aguero's not going to leave.
Keep your paws off Firmino, by the way.
Yeah, so... I don't know.
But the work that... Firmino does off the ball too is outstanding.
He's
a freak. I want to move on because we could get bogged down in this conversation, and we'll look at the next result between Chelsea and Crystal Palace, and a comment that's come through via Facebook thanks to Mehmet Jamal. Very, very good comment from you, and I laughed when I saw the result as well. Lucy slated Alvaro Morata so much that he scored a brace. I did hammer the guy. I did, because you know what? He came in with good stats and a good pedigree, and I expected to see more of him at Chelsea, but he just wasn't delivering. And I just thought every time I'd watched him, he had an underwhelming game. Well, he was extremely overwhelming in that game. Bagged the brace, but with the greatest of respect, it was against Crystal Palace, so let's not get too excited. Yeah. Stolich?
And also, you know what? That's what Lucy does. She bags people and they get inspired. Obviously, Alvaro was watching in London.
Who's this mole in Australia telling me I'm ordinary? What are you doing with your life?
She's giving off a glowing vibe of pregnancy. I must listen to her. But he's come good. And you know what? Well done to Surrey for showing faith in him and not just discarding him. Okay, this guy's finished. This guy's no good.
That's true. That's a good point.
He gets the best out of a lot of these players. So, you know, it's good for Alvaro Morata. It's good for Chelsea. I think they're 16 games unbeaten, haven't lost, 13 wins. Extremely good. Hazard coming off the bench, getting an assist almost immediately. So, you know, good work, Chelsea. Nice goal, Morata.
I agree. Elsewhere, wow. This was slated to be a cracker, and I'm happy to take the point at the Emirates, because it's going to make for a sensational second match at Anfield. Yeah. Brilliant stuff. Arsenal just on fire at the moment, and it was a real joy to watch this game. Brilliant. We finished 1-1 between the Gunners and the Reds. What did you make of it and the overall reaction? Stolich.
I thought it was a top game. You know, top Premier League game, lots of chances both sides. Like, this is one of those things where it's hard to fault either side because they were both good in patches.
Yeah.
And I thought, amazing goal from Lacazette.
Brilliant at the moment.
Yeah, and you know what? Like, Iwobi came off the bench and set that up. And that's been one of the highlights for Arsenal. The people coming off the bench have been very strong, whether it's been Aubameyang, whether it's been
Look at who
Iwobi.
You've got to come off the bench. Even Welbeck's all strong
doing
options.
Well. Yeah, you know, so really good. I think
I still prefer Aubameyang and Lacazette playing together. Start them, and I think they're just such a beautiful goal scoring pair.
Yeah, I definitely want to see that. And Ozil as well is really, at the start he wasn't, you know, playing all that much or being involved all that much, and now he's really starting to hit his form. He was amazing the other week against Everton. So really good stuff from Arsenal.
All that criticism that Mesut Ozil was heaped with at that time, did you find any validity to it? Was there genuine justification behind it?
The thing is, Mesut Ozil is one of those players who he doesn't move all that much. He's an incredibly intelligent player, always, like, you know, making assists and all that stuff. But because of the way, it's kind of like, remember Berbatov back in the day, they have a very languid style. So they get, it's the first one to criticize is the one who's not moving too much.
Yep.
But if you even look at the top players, Messi, for example, runs the absolute least for Barcelona. But when you need him to run, he is the one sprinting at the top pace. That's what it's about. It's what Cruyff used to say. It's about being smart with your movement.
Well, he was very big on being smart with your feet too. Facebookers, Twitter users, Mesut Ozil, yay or nay? It'll be interesting to see what everyone else thinks. Jordan Minter via Facebook, good afternoon to you. Jordan, Unai Emery needs a true number 10 like Ozil.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, definitely working for him. I thought Mane's goal should have been ruled onside, because I know he was offside initially, but then Firmino, I think, gets in, hits the bar, and then Mane should have been onside, which actually, and I know a lot of people are very anti-VAR in the last couple of weeks, That should have been a goal. And if I was a Liverpool fan, I'd be a little annoyed by that.
Look, I didn't want to bring it up because I was wanting to have a very calm Facebook Live slash the World Game Live in general. But I'm going to let that one slide because I'll get too worked up and I don't want to. But
a big test for Arsenal. Massive test.
But they've been in sensational form. Yeah. All right. And I had question marks. Yeah. I'm not going to lie. When Emery came on board, I thought, what style of football is he going to play? And it took me some time to figure out what he was trying to do. He was playing Ramsey in an interesting position. Yeah. Those first couple of games, I thought, what's happening here? But now they've really adapted to his style, and I think well done, because this is what Gunners fans have been crying out
100%.
For. They've been crying out for success. The whole atmosphere has changed, and still with the greatest of respect to Arsene Wenger, who is still one of the greatest coaches, in our era. I think everything that he achieved at that club was outstanding. But I think he did need to go. They needed a refresh, and it's come in the form of Unai Emery. So let's see how well they can do.
That has been proven with these results and these performances. So, really, so I want to say as well, I thought Lucas Torreira, their defensive midfielder, that's exactly
they brought him in the summer.
Yeah,
quality
that's
player.
Exactly the type of player that Arsenal.
Guendouzi as well, very good.
Very good. But I have a little theory about Guendouzi.
What is it?
Well,
I like a good theory.
Here's a theory.
Conspiracy or otherwise.
So this is especially careful for parents of junior footballers. You should listen to this too. Now, Guendouzi, big mop hair, right? David Luiz, big mop hair. Who are the players that always stand out with that big mop hair? You always notice them. So therefore, you think they're having more of an impact in the game than you would think for other players.
You're taking the piss.
No, 100%. I'm telling you.
David Luiz.
If you want your
kids
to stand out.
Yeah, we all know how his big hair worked out at the Brazil World Cup.
I know. Yeah, well, he got more blame for it. He did get more blame for it. Because
he got blamed because he was shit.
Yeah, but you
That's
see
why,
him.
Not because of his haircut.
I'm telling you, you notice players more when they have kind of crazy out their hair. So if you want a player to stand out, whether for good or for bad, that's sometimes...
Flamini?
Yeah, there's all that kind of... Yeah, Fellaini, all that kind of stuff.
It's a very interesting theory, but I'm...
The other one, Ryan Granit's in the FC.
Oh, my God.
Terrible, absolutely terrible haircut, but he is rocking it, and he is back in form, and we are noticing it, because every single time...
You can't tell me that he's back in form because of his haircut.
No.
Can't tell me you're noticing him being back in form because of his haircut.
That's what I just did.
All right, so are you going to come in with a ridiculous haircut tomorrow and we're going to notice your work, levels and your output spike?
No, because in the same way that I'm a David Luiz, if I too much hair, you're going to notice all the bad stuff I'm doing. I need to kind of fly under the radar and do well.
Kate Johnson, Fellaini's sideshow, Bob. Oh, yeah. My gosh.
I'm telling you notice them when they're on the pitch. It's
Christopher
important.
Martin via Facebook, can you imagine that haircut gracing the Prem?
The Ryan Grant.
Yeah. Look, I think that haircut's been given enough attention, to be fair. And he even mentioned it in his post-match interviews. Like, I'm just having to crack the same jokes every week. Whether he's doing it for banter or not, I think, good
Socceroos
on your own.
Socceroos selection.
Or Socceroos selection, because apparently, according to you, there's a theory that you'll get selected for the Socceroos if you have a stupid haircut.
You'll get noticed.
you'll get noticed. All right, I'll change my tune on that one. Elsewhere, really big win for Spurs, just very quickly as we wrap through some of the key results over... Wolverhampton Wanderers at Molineux Stadium, 3-2, the full-time result. Man, they needed that, Spurs, didn't they?
I thought Wolves were a bit unlucky, actually. Quite a few chances.
I rate them. I like Wolves.
Yeah, and Spurs were just a bit more clinical, so, and this is the thing. As much as they're struggling, they're getting the results, and that is important. So
Chris Womt via Facebook, Moy to grow an afro.
Yeah, I don't think he can. That's one of his issues. That's why he's a bit out of form, by the way.
Here we go. Here's something supporting your theory via Sebastian Martinez on Facebook as well. Didn't even know who Ryan Grant was before that mullet haircut.
That's what I'm saying. Sebastian knows. Vamos, Sebastian. Vamos.
Yes, Santino Mamone. I'm really glad you mentioned this because we're going to talk about Manchester United's result as well over Bournemouth at the Vitality Stadium, which we covered it on SBS on Saturday night, early hours of Sunday morning. It was a big result for Manchester United. They obviously needed it, given the form that they've been in. They struggled against Juve. They lost that game at Old Trafford. Then beat Everton,
the OG Trafford.
Then came back and got the job done away from home, which was a very important win for them. But Matty Ryan has been linked to the Manchester United gig in goals should David De Gea depart. The Sharks are apparently circling for David De Gea. Juve are apparently in the running, and PSG have come out and said that they would offer the 27-year-old shot stopper anything that he wanted. Now, we know they're just rumours at this point, but Matty Ryan being linked to one of the biggest clubs in the world, that is huge, Stolic. Your thoughts on that, guys? What's the reaction?
Massive. He's in really good form at the moment. I know he conceded at the weekend, but before that he had 3 clean sheets in a row. It would be a huge step up.
But is it a step up that he's capable of commanding?
I mean, I would like to say yes, and you know, you have faith, and I think he's a very, very good keeper,
mm-hmm.
but that's a big step up. And to follow De Gea, who has been Manchester United's probably best player of the last 4 years,
ooh.
Right? It's a lot to do. And you know what? They had such trouble filling in Schmeichel's shoes back in the day, or gloves, as you will.
Yep.
And then they had a lot of trouble filling Van der Sar. So it's like, the big names, it's very tough to do. So, you know, I think obviously it'd be massive for Australia if they were to do it. But right now, you'd just be like, you know, you wouldn't put your house on it being a huge success straight away. But, you know, it could be, at least.
Here's the question, though. Mm. If it's not Matty Ryan, then who is it? Because, yeah. as you've said, there's some big gloves to fill.
Yeah.
If David De Gea does go, which other big keepers around the world are available and could they get? And even bigger is the question of what price tag comes with it. Because we saw what Kepa Arrizabalaga commanded when he went over to Chelsea from Bilbao.
Yeah.
What could Matty Ryan get if he was to go to Manchester United, or any other keeper for that matter?
I'd imagine Jordan Pickford would be high on Manchester United's list. Obviously, England international, did very well at the World Cup, good with his feet.
He did well at the World Cup, but I don't know that he's been outstanding since then, with the greatest of respect.
Yeah, okay, that's fair enough. So, I don't know, I imagine he'd be up there. I'm sure there are keepers across the other leagues that they'd all be, you know, we've seen how well Kepa has done. Not that many people in England had heard of Kepa before he was at Bilbao.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it'd be interesting to see what they go with. But yeah, if they go with Matty Ryan, well, that would be an unbelievable story.
Oblak, another suggestion via Facebook.
I think Simeone is more likely to release his children than release Oblak. Oblak saves that team. So Oblak is maybe the best goalkeeper in the world, along with De Gea and Ter Stegen, I would say. So, no chance. But you know what, as
good
well?
Call.
Because maybe Navas, because is Navas going, you know what, they've brought in Courtois, I'm only playing in the cup, I've got to sit in the league, that's not good enough, I want to be playing everything. I'm a Champions League winner, you know, I've won leagues. So I think maybe Keylor Navas.
All right, could be, interesting to see, but you know what, if Matty Ryan is to go across to Manchester United, what a win that would be for Australian football, for him, for kids everywhere, looking up to a player of that quality and calibre and aspiring to be like him, it'd be huge for us.
And top dude, I spoke to him before
the
season.
He's a great guy, he is a really great guy.
Really, really good guy, so it was really good to see him doing well.
Santino Mamone, one final thing on this, Buffon was a club legend until he went to PSG, I agree with that.
Yeah.
You?
Yeah, of course. Well, okay, this is the frustrating thing, it's like, I know he probably got his big last payday at PSG. But come on, man, you already would have made so much money. You were playing for 20 years, right? And also, you're a legend. You're going to still get sponsorship deals and all that stuff. You can, you know, find incomes everywhere else. Why are you going to go to PSG and ruin that kind of legacy?
Did Juve want to hang on to him, though? This is
no,
a question
I
that.
Think so.
There you go. So, this is the thing that we need to ask is that did Buffon make the decision to leave? And now we're tracking back, clearly, the deal's already been done. But did he make the decision to leave, or did Juve say, you know what, we're going to allow you to retire with the club on your terms? And what you do post that is entirely your decision. But we're not interested in keeping you on for another season.
And that's true. And you've got to respect his decision. And if that's it, you know what? He's still a legend, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
But I would have preferred to see him go back to his, you know, home team, Parma, or something like that, where he started all those years ago. Or, you know, even, hey, come to the A-League.
Well,
you know,
if you want some cashola, you're chasing the spandoulis. Go to China like the rest of them.
Yeah, China, the US, whatever.
MLS would be nice.
Yeah, so, I don't know. Look, he's gone to PSG. Maybe he loves the baguettes of Paris. And you know what? That's it.
I wouldn't mind the baguettes of Paris
either. Exactly.
Look, let's just quickly talk about, you know, the way that the table's looking at the moment. So you've got Man City on top on 29 points, Chelsea on 27, likewise with Liverpool separated only by goal difference. And then you've got Tottenham in fourth. Then you've got Arsenal, apologies, on 23 points,
one point
behind Spurs, which makes for a very, very interesting Premier League season thus far. If you had to pick a top four now, I feel like I ask this every week because it's constantly changing, but is that looking more like what it could be at the end of the year, or do you see Arsenal creeping in there? I personally, that's how I see it.
That's exactly what I see. Tottenham are going to drop out. This thing is going to fall off. They've been getting kind of lucky. You know, we were saying the performance has been bad, but they've been getting the results.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's more likely at this stage that not the performance will increase, but the results will decrease.
Mm.
You know, and I think with this stadium drama, Poch not happy, injuries, I think it's going to go. And Arsenal are looking stronger and stronger, getting more confident with every result. So, you know, if Arsenal go away to Manchester United, which I think they have to do in a couple of weeks,
like,
I think that could be huge. So, yeah, I think Arsenal are going to sneak in there.
All right. One final comment, deferring back to our conversation on Buffon from Al-Saad El Musti via Facebook. Greetings to you. Maybe he wants one last chance to win Champions League. It's
PSG.
The one thing that's eluded him. But this is the thing. I don't think he's going to win it with PSG either.
No.
I don't think they're going to be... they're going to be in the final. At the very least, do I believe they're going
to
win it.
They were lucky to get a 2-2 with Napoli at home. So
Tuchel has a big job ahead of him, doesn't
he? PSG might not even get out of the group. So I understand, yeah, maybe it was his last chance to win a Champions League, but I don't know. I'm sure he could have gone to City as a second keeper.
You want to go to City as a second keeper?
No, you win a Champions League.
Well, you've still got a bit of gas in you. I doubt they would have given him any cashola over it.
Yeah.
One last result in the Premier League that we'll talk about before we move on to the A-League. We'll get back to domestic shores. This was a highly emotional game for so many people involved, and it took place between Cardiff City and Leicester City, in which Leicester, via Damari Gray, got the goal and 3 points. And the big talking point around this, aside from the fact that it was very emotional for the players, saw Kasper Schmeichel in tears, a really, really tragic time. It's still quite shocking to even think about the gravity and get your head around the magnitude of what's happened. But the big talking point was around Damari Gray being booked.
Yeah.
And being given a yellow card for taking his shirt off and celebrating after the goal. Stolich, over to you. Thoughts, guys, via Facebook and ladies and Twitter. What do you think? Should he have been given that yellow card or not?
I obviously think he shouldn't have been given that yellow card.
You don't think he should have been given the card?
I think the referee should have just gone, well, whatever, like, I know, blah, blah. But it is in the rules, and the referee has to apply those rules. But I think, you know, given the context, we all know what this is. Let's have the nuance to know when to give a yellow card and when not to. And to be honest, I think it's a lame rule that players get in trouble for taking their shirt off. To be honest, you know what it all stems from is the sponsors are on there, and they know that the goals are what's shown on news and highlights and all that kind of thing. So the sponsors want to be shown. Let's forget the sponsors for 1 week and not worry about it. I think, you know, it was clearly a message in a time of extreme trauma for this club. So I think, but I also think, by the way, I saw a lot of people like abusing the referee and all that thing. I think that's a bit harsh because he is applying, you know, you could say he didn't really want to do it. He had to apply the rules as it is. So I don't think he should have done it, but also don't, you know, abuse the referee because of it.
Yeah. I think it's a good point. I'm going to defer to social media to see what everyone's saying about it. Christopher Martin via Facebook, the black band on the arm is a sign of respect. The poppy on the jersey is a sign of respect, both within the rules. Taking your shirt off is not. I know I might sound like a bit of a monster given the circumstances, but I think to abuse the referee in these circumstances is well out of line. It's bang out of order. Now, the guy was doing his job. And my only question is this. I understand how tragic a scenario this is, but if you make an acceptance there, then you have to start to make acceptances elsewhere. So if a player's, you know, if someone at the club passes away and then a player does it the following week, and let's say that it was a long-serving staff member, are you going to then be able to make the same argument? And if the ref gives a yellow but he didn't give it for Damari, then do you see what I mean? You open up Pandora's box. So I agree that it was a difficult circumstance for everybody involved, but, you know, we give the refs a lot of stick, and the guy was just doing his job.
Yeah, I definitely think you shouldn't have been abused. But you know what? Get rid of that rule about not taking off the shirt. When I was a junior player, the celebration we all love to do was the one shirt over the head and you just run around.
Yeah, the shirt over the head was good. The shirt over the head was good.
Bring it back, you know? Yeah. The sponsors get enough. You know, money anyways.
Ivan Stragan, I see both sides of the yellow card, but if they allow one person to do it, it will just snowball to everyone, which feeds into what I'm saying. Daniel Manfrey via Facebook as well. Gray knew what he was doing and knew the yellow was coming. I'm sure most of the players would have had the same undershirt as he did if they had scored. But the players did have a very strong reaction to Damari being given that yellow card in the first place, though.
Yeah.
Anyway, let's move on. Let's move on to the A-League because we've spoken a lot about the Premier League. But before we do, actually, I want to get this piece of news in there. And it is about Daniel Alzani, our very own bright, hopeful future of Australian football, has been delivered a massive blow. It still hasn't been 100% confirmed as to the extent of his injury. So many theories being thrown around there that it's potentially his ACL. Could it be his PCL? Has he done some other form of damage? We still don't know. The club are yet to confirm it. But there are reports, Stolich, that he is going to Spain, was it, that you were talking about earlier to have surgery?
Yeah, so because obviously it's part of the City Football Group, they send a lot of their injured players to Spain to work with like a renowned worldwide expert about especially knee injuries and stuff. Of course, Benjamin Mendy had a knee injury last season.
Ruled him out for virtually the entire season.
Exactly. He went to Barcelona. They seem to have fixed the problem. You know, because a lot of players, especially fast players, Azani's one of them, they don't quite recover that same speed. So I think it's very important they go the exact right person who knows, who is a specialist in not only this injury, but footballers, and exactly kind of what they need to rebuild for the kind of pressure that they're going to be under going forward. So, yeah, really bad news for Daniel Azani. I thought he looked really good in his 20 minutes that he came on for Celtic.
And it was his debut for the senior team as well. It's just gut-wrenching. I really feel for the lad. And all of our thoughts here at the World Game, of course, are with him. We wish him all the very best in terms of his recovery. But, you know, the even bigger blow for me, aside from the fact that he won't be featuring for Celtic for the remainder of the season as it stands, it's looking quite likely, but that we miss out on seeing him for the Asian Cup.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, to me, he was our most exciting player at the World Cup. So really, at the Asian Cup was like his chance to really start games, really make a statement. But, you know, it is very unfortunate. You know, we're hoping for the best. But you know what? It always injuries open up opportunities for other players, whether that be Awar Mabil, who did very well in the last Socceroos game.
Or Craig Goodwin.
Craig Goodwin.
Yes. Exactly. Now, that's where the conversation's turning to, because it appears, and I think I've heard this more times than I've thought today, but everything that that man is touching turns to gold at this stage. So we saw him with those sensational two goals in the FFA Cup in which Adelaide defeated Sydney during the week. Then they came out against the Mariners, absolutely belted. The Mariners were awful, with the greatest of respect. But he, again, was brilliant. A goal and an assist. I mean, just on fire.
Eight goals in seven matches for Adelaide this season. So, yeah, I think he needs to be in the Socceroos. I think it's clear, especially with Azani not being there. Now is it's his chance to go. I think it was sensational in the FA Cup final, which was a great night, I think, for Australian football.
On his left foot, then his right. Yeah. Both of them just peaches. Yeah. Peaches.
And that's the thing. Like, a lot of people, I was saying, a lot of people comparing him to Gareth Bale. Gareth Bale's out of form. Gareth Bale's crap.
But can I just say, you recant that tweet you put up? Because it was so good. I remember actually being on the couch and saying it out loud to Corey. We had a good giggle about it. Say it.
I was just saying that, like, a lot of people, because I even think the way he looks, but the way he plays, the way he's converted from left back to left wing, there was a lot of comparisons. Oh, Craig Goodwin is Australia's Gareth Bale and all that. Gareth Bale is crap at the moment. Do not compare him to... Mate, Craig Goodwin is a superstar right now.
Is it almost an insult to compare him to that?
But you know what? Craig Goodwin's in such good form now. Are Adelaide going to hang on to him? I know he's just got there beyond January. Because if I was him, I'd be looking... I know it didn't exactly work out for him at Sparta Rotterdam in Holland, but man, he's a top, top player. I think if he keeps on this form, he's going to be going back to Europe.
Okay, so how do you see then this Socceroos camp looking? Because that's going to be the next big question, right?
I think Craig Goodwin's going to be in there. I think Ryan Grant's going to be in there.
Yeah.
Because Josh Risden's been the right back for the Socceroos. And with the respect to Risden, I think Grant's been better in the last couple of weeks.
I'd have to agree with you there. So, I would.
Obviously, Ryan Grant had a knee injury last season, so that kind of, you know, ruled him out for a while. But you got to remember as well, this is Arnie's squad. And Arnie knows Ryan Grant very well.
He does.
And trusted him in a lot of big games. So I think, I think Ryan Grant's going to be in there. I think Craig Goodwin's going to be in there. I'm excited to see, you know, how it all shakes out.
Everybody, virtually everybody, is saying that Craig Goodwin via our social medias, whether it be across Twitter or Facebook, are all in agreement. Hassan Bertan, good day to you. Goodwin should be picked to the Socceroos. Luca Jordine, Grant versus Risden by far. I think Alex Kosovsky, Grant's mullet will get a cap as well.
Yeah, I'm telling you.
Shannon Martin, Grant needs a haircut. Yeah, it seems to be the talk of the town, but I think what's doing more of the talking for Ryan Grant, which I'm pleased about, is the football that he's playing at the moment. And I agree. I think he does deserve an opportunity.
Who was sensational? So Grant and Paolo Retre, scoring against his old club, setting
up
games.
How good was Paolo Retre in that game?
Grant, Retre and Lafondre all were involved in two of the goals there, and that was a wonderful move where Grant played the ball, Retre first time into Lafondre, great finish. Man, Sydney FC did really well to respond to that FA Cup loss.
Loss, I agree.
You know, which is hard, a couple of days off, away again.
Let's just say this right now, and let's talk about that game, seeing that you've gotten onto that subject, but Melbourne City, they were bad. They were awful.
Yeah, they were crap.
That was really difficult to watch because, you know what, I look at this team, I look at this squad on paper, and I think this is a team that could actually do some damage and can be quite competitive. But then it materialises on the pitch and you just think, what am I watching? What's happened here? Their build-up is so laborious. A lot of linear movement, side-to-side passing. No real penetration going forward. I want to see this club do well. I know last week I was talking a lot of smack about them, saying, you know, I find them to be a bit plastic and lacking any kind of a connection to their fans or club culture. But I want to see them do well because of the City Group backing, because of the resources and the investments that they've got at their disposal. Yeah. It just cannot translate onto the pitch. So it just goes to show you that money can't buy you titles. But why were they so bad, Stolich? Why?
Well, you said they're good on paper. But what else is at the bottom of that paper?
Coach.
Warren Joyce. I just don't think he's up to it.
I don't think he is either.
He's had enough time here. You know, he's had a lot of resources. He's had a lot of top players. And he just hasn't really done it. You know, so... I mean, I've said before that I think City are just a development club. It's not very good at developing players at the moment. You know, obviously Azani was there last year, but, you know, right now at the moment, Joyce doesn't look like he knows what he's doing. He's played in the number 10 role. He's played, I think, Vidicic, Caceres. Who was the guy who scored the amazing goal last season for Newcastle and he's transferred down? I'm forgetting his name right now.
Riley McGree.
He's played Riley McGree in the number 10. So if you've played three games, you've played three different number 10s. No wonder Fornaroli's looking around like, why can't I get proper service? So... City were crap.
Fornaroli looks like he's struggling.
City were crap. Joyce.
And he's a great player,
you know,
too.
But you know what? The weird thing about the City Group is I thought they would be much more ruthless with their coaches here. But, you know, Van Schip had a long time there where he wasn't kind of under
then
pressure.
Then they had Valkanis in the role. Then that all went sour. And then they've brought in Warren Joyce. And that just doesn't seem to be working quite well. Yeah. I mean, you consider kind of his man management, for example, and the way that he's treated some players that have been at the club. I know that Neil Kilkenny was having a very rough time there towards the back end where he just wasn't being included in the squad at all. And he's a quality player. I find it all a little bit too peculiar for my liking. Yeah. And interesting too, they brought back Mark Birigidi, but then they seem to be persisting with Eugene Galekovic. And Eugene Galekovic, we know, has been an epic keeper by A-League standards over the years, but I'm not sure entirely that he's still got it and that he's still there. And Birigidi's a quality keeper. We saw what he could achieve with Newcastle Jets when he was there, when they went overseas, came back. I thought, okay, They've filled Bouzanis' shoes, and I expected Birigidi to be featuring in goals for them. Interesting player selection choices from Joyce. That's all I'll say.
Yeah, I'm not rating it. I think, like, unless kind of performances and results improve, I think they need to get rid of him. And you know what? All the resources that City have, you know, at New York City, they've got Pep's assistant from last season at Manchester City, who's been with him all season. So the quite, like, high-quality coaches that they're getting at New York City FC. Melbourne City, I just don't think we're seeing that level of coaching.
I'm telling you, I feel like the City Group are treating this club in Melbourne like it's the poor cousin born of incest.
Yeah.
They've got a lot of children, but this one just seems to be the black sheep.
Mm.
And they're not being given a lot of love. Love them, City Group, love them. We want this club to be competitive. We want to see them doing well and forge a connection with the fans and build a good club culture.
All that kind of stuff. And they have the resources to do it. So... Yeah, big shame. But yeah, I thought...
Hey, Johnson, Fornaroli, I feel sorry for him via Facebook. I do too.
Fornaroli, for me, was when he was really on fire that season, I think he scored like 25 goals.
Oh.
He was one of the all-time great A-League players. So he was sensational. And all he needed was good service, Aaron Moy, behind him. He doesn't have that at the moment.
Something's not right there. But something is right at Sydney FC. Again, the biggest question mark leading into this season was whether or not Bimby, their coach, Steve Corica, was going to be able to carry on the Graham Arnold legacy and still steer the ship towards success, given that they'd achieved so much under Arnie. And so far, so good. 3-0.
Yeah.
I mean, but they're missing Siem Dyong, out injured for at least 5 to 6 weeks with a hamstring problem.
Yep, and he did have injury problems before he came here, so they probably should have at least been prepared for that. And you know what? Paolo Retre stepped up. It was a wonderful ball in like the kind of number 10 position. So I think he's really pushing for selection.
A real utility player too. Can play in various positions as well, which is a massive bonus.
And used to be at City, and now City are like struggling for that player. So what's going on there? I think massively Ninkovic is looking really good as well. And Lafondra.
Lafondra,
6 goals in 6 games.
Christopher Martin via Facebook. Glad you mentioned him. Lafondra to do a bobo.
Yeah. Well, you know what? I mean, this is the other thing. Is it the system that gets the best out of these strikers? Because Bobo, Lafondra, they're all doing well. Even Mark Janko before that was scoring low goals for Sydney FC.
He was great too, wasn't he?
Yeah. So, you know, you got to say, Sydney FC, for years they had problems with number nines and they had people like Bruno Cazzarine and all these kind of random people there. But They seem like they've really found it. Lafondre looks like a great, great signing. I personally had my doubts when they signed him. I thought,
did you?
Yeah, I just didn't think, like, you know, is that bigger name, was that kind of be that thing. I thought Bobo, there's a lot of goals there to replace, but you know what?
Yeah, but you probably thought the same about Bobo when he arrived.
Yeah,
and this is the thing. This is what I actually do like about the A-League. When you do get these players, these foreigners come across, everyone kind of groans and thinks, oh, it's not someone that I know and they don't come from good pedigree. Who are these guys?
Yeah.
And then they end up turning it on and putting on a show. Ninkovic is another player there. I mean, we've
Fornaroli was one.
We've seen some Bessar Berisha, another one. Thomas Broich, another one. Like, these are players that have arrived to Australia and really, really entertained us all. Daniel Manfrey via Facebook. De Jong isn't a massive loss, in my opinion. Looks lazy.
Ooh. I don't know. I thought he was very good in the FA Cup semi-final where he hit that beautiful free kick and he set things up. Yeah, he's a player that doesn't move too much, but, you know, neither does Mesut Ozil, like we were saying before. So,
hang on a second. You can't compare them to Mesut Ozil and come on. A-League
means... CM De Jong had a crazier haircut. You'd notice him more.
Oh, you and those crazy haircuts. I'm almost devastated that Usain Bolt didn't stick around so I could shave my head. Then we'll see what you'd have to say about that.
That's
A-League
true.
Memes. I love your account. It's hilarious.
Yeah.
Absence makes the heart grows Lafondre.
Oh, that is some amazing pun work. But also
we're getting the wind up. Go away, Nikki. Go away. Go away.
Yeah. What do you reckon about he who must not be named?
Voldemort.
Did Mariners lack a bit of pace against Adelaide?
Oh, don't do that. Don't put me in that situation. All I'll say is, you know what? The experiment has been, it was attempted, it failed, and now it's over. Now we can resume back to normal now and enjoy the fact that it's just about the football. Mariners put in a very poor shift against Adelaide, and we can talk about that now. Obviously, Craig Goodwin we discussed briefly and how exceptional he has been, but this is a poor result for Central Coast, and Mike Mulvey, it appears, has to go back to the drawing board a little bit after that one.
You know what? I think the Bolt thing has distracted them.
There was, you think?
All this chaos around it. You know, it just seems like there has been an issue. And you know what? That, who was it? Ben Kennedy, the goalkeeper? Honestly, that was a shocking mistake.
It was a terrible mistake, and we've seen some howlers from keepers over the years, but that was pretty poor.
I mean, Craig Goodwin looked guilty celebrating it. He kind of ran away and went like, thanks, mate. You know, I was actually already going to be in the Socceroos. You didn't have to let me have that one. But yeah, no, really bad stuff for the Mariners. But I don't know. I think there's a good squad. They'll turn it around. You know, we'll see the best out of like Ross McCormack and Tommy Orr and all those kind of guys.
Mm-hmm.
So I think they will turn it around. But, you know, this Bolt thing, you know, they definitely got a lot of publicity out of it, but what did it cost them? And also, I think bollocks on Bolt for saying, it's my dream to be a footballer. Okay, we're going to offer you not a big contract, but you're not in this for the money. You shouldn't be getting a lot of money. You should be getting actually nearly the minimum wage because you have absolutely no experience.
And I like what Sasha Ognjenovsky had to say about it. We ran a story online on the World Game in which he said, you know, Bolt is basically nobody in the football world. When I started at Brisbane, I was on a minimum wage contract of 50K a season. And he said, I've been playing football my whole life. But look, I'm glad that we don't have to talk about it anymore and that now it is just about the football because that's why we're all here, right? This is the whole
100%.
Point. The A-League season has started. We've gotten past the circus of all of that. And we can go, as I said, back to talking about the football. But let's now move on to the result between Wellington Phoenix and Western Sydney Wanderers. Wanderers have been honking so far this season. They've desperately needed results, and they got it done in the cake tin. The windy Wellington.
Oh, my God.
Right.
Now, shocking
that
conditions.
That was hard. That was hard to watch.
I would have got myself sent off if I was playing, just to go sit in the change room.
Well, you know what? I think most of the players would look back in hindsight and wish they could have done that too. Terry Lucas via Facebook, is the honeymoon over for Mark Rudan?
It's probably
a bit early.
Hey,
it's not one
of the honeymoon, you know.
It's
just because the candles have been blown out. Doesn't mean the romance is over.
We can create the mood again. The candles blew out, but honey, let me just put on a negligee. Let me just dress up the curtains. Let me just...
Negligee is one of the most old words I've ever heard. Negligee.
You don't rate negligee?
No, I don't rate
What's
negligee.
Wrong with negligee? It is a very old world kind of thing to say, isn't it?
It feels like, I don't know.
I don't know. I'm pregnant now. I'm getting on. I'm going to be 32 on Friday. What are you getting me for my birthday?
A lot of baby clothes, I guess, now. Baby onesies.
Not any baby clothes yet. It's still about me.
All right, maternity clothes. 100%.
Maternity clothes.
Some kind of clothes. Anthony Serkis, send more maternity t-shirts in.
Oh, look, I'm getting a good stretch out of this one. So the quality of these shirts, I will say, is absolutely exemplary.
Now, you know, I will say that Wellington game, there was honestly...
Talk to me, because they were bad conditions.
The conditions were so bad. At one stage, Burgess took a corner. It changed time zone. It was going...
Completely.
Like, it was going to, like, the edge of the box, and then it hit the side netting. It was crazy. So, you know what? But you know what? Wellington should be more used to those conditions. I know they have got a lot of new signings. But it was the Wanderers who did well. I thought Kamau...
They needed that result. Kamau
was good.
Needed that bad.
Yeah, so I think, you know, Jordan O'Doherty... And actually, it scored his first goal for the club. I want to say... Andrew Durante, 250 games for the Knicks, you know? It is, like, nice to see. Like,
he's legendary,
yeah,
really.
It's a young competition, so we don't have too many of these records, but 250 A-League games when there's only 27 a season.
And let's say, shout out to Drew, who is, like, the loveliest, loveliest guy, too, by the way. A real gentleman on and off the pitch and a great leader at that club, too. So I think it's great that he's still continuing to play on and to be a servant for the Knicks. But not a good result for them. I still don't think that the honeymoon period is over just yet.
Let's get out
the negligee, Rudes. You'll be fine. All right. Melbourne victory. Wow. The grand final replay at Hunter Stadium between the Jets and the victory. The victory walked away 1-0 winners. Your thoughts on that one?
I thought, great to see Honda get another assist. He's been involved in every single
He's
Melbourne
been epic, hasn't
victory
he? I love it.
Goal. Great strike by Terry Antonis. And also, a bit of a weird thing with apparently Merrick and Musket not shaking hands at the end of the game. There's some weird... They seem to hate each other. They refuse to do a press conference together at the final.
There's got to be a lot of tension there, and I think that so much of that has to come from the situation that occurred in the grand final.
Yeah, maybe. I don't know. Like, to be honest, it's weird because obviously they worked together for so many years at Victory when Merrick was the coach, Musket was the captain. Then Musket was actually an assistant for a while under Merrick. I think he was still playing at the time or whatever. But anyway, at the moment, it seems like they don't even talk. They don't shake hands. And to be honest, I don't think it's the best look for two coaches.
Yeah,
not
but
to
can
be
we
shaken
just...
Hands.
You know what? I remember asking Ned this question many years ago when I asked him why he didn't get along with a particular player or, you know, what the story is when, you know, it comes to kind of team culture and how the whole dynamics work.
Yeah.
And he said to me, he put it the best. Ned's very straight to the point. He doesn't... Yeah. Oftentimes, he doesn't have to say too much and I just sit back and I go, actually, you bang on there.
Mm.
But he said to me, have you ever worked with people you don't like? And I was like, fucking all the time. I'm kidding.
No.
I said, oh yeah, of course, all the time. It's quite common. From whichever job I've held, there have been people that you either clash with or you don't see eye to eye with. But he said, well, that's the same thing in football.
Yeah.
Everyone has this misconception that you're all in the dressing room slapping each other's asses, going around for dinner to eat, you and your missus, they all hang out together with the mates and their missus. It's not like that. Within a particular work environment, your own cliques form, there'll be some people you despise, and that's quite normal. So when I see these tensions occur in football now, having a bit more of that insight, I kind of think, well, it's quite normal. And why are we getting so worked up over it?
Are
you
normal.
Looking at it more from a professionalism perspective?
I think it's good to show, especially to so many kids watching, that you might not like the person you're up against or even your own teammate. But
sportsmanship?
As long as that no one has, like, you know, I don't know, really done something heinous to another person, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I think a handshake should always be done at the end of the game, you know, like, only in exceptional
circumstances.
Well,
we don't know. Maybe there was something heinous that occurred between the two of them.
But anyway, the Jets still haven't won a game, bottom of the ladder. And you know what? I mean, there's a lot of players, injuries, suspensions.
I don't think they recruited well enough for this season, to be honest. They got Vargas back, which is great, after he broke his leg in that horrific challenge last season. But I don't think that's enough. I don't think they bought well enough in the in the off-season.
I mean, we'll see. We'll see when all those players come back. Got to give them a bit more time. You know, no honeymoons are over just yet. It's very early in the season.
Well...
What?
People want to know this, and it's come via Terry Lucas. I'm glad you mentioned that via Facebook. Good day to you, Terry. What about
what
the
up,
honeymoon
Terry?
For John Aloisi? Bing.
Honeymoon? He's been there years. He's like fourth year into the marriage. Up
no,
there.
But let's talk about because I feel like at the start of every season, it's like you've renewed your vows.
Yeah, nice.
And you're back again, right? Yeah. So I feel like the honeymoon period is over, but we know that JA and and the entire coaching staff there go through this period now, 4 years into the marriage, where they start seasons off poorly.
Yeah.
Now, JA's cooking about it. He's not happy, and there's a story via the World Game if you want to check it out. But thoughts around Brisbane, because it's been another poor start to the season for them. They lost away to Perth. Perth, by the way, if they're not up there by the end of the season, I swear to you, something will be gravely wrong. But they look incredible. But let's isolate the discussion around Brisbane right now. What's going on?
I mean, they weren't great against Perth, but I just thought Perth were very, very good. And that is very hard to go away to Perth. I think it's the longest trip outside of Wellington to make it to Perth, to go there and get a result. And you know what? It's not been great for the Raw early, but I still think it's early days. And I think Perth were sensational.
Perth were sensational.
On that left side, Economidis, Davidson, brilliant. Brilliant.
Very good.
And you know what? Economidis might be pushing for Socceroos selection.
And
eventually,
we have seen him within camps and out over the, you know, the past couple of years. So it could be interesting to see how that turns out for him.
But Popper's doing it. Mate, the honeymoon is on for Popper.
Oh,
Popper's having
like
the best honeymoon of all time.
That's candles, that's chocolate, that's good morning, honey. I love you every day. Yeah, like no arguments, nothing.
No. It's good, it's good.
That is a match made in heaven.
I like he's playing three at the back. He's kind of doing that Conte kind of thing that Conte did at Chelsea. And Economidis is really working. And they've got Diego Castro, who for me is their best player to come back, and
because he was like a ghost last season. Castro, he'd gone from being the Johnny Warren medalist to being outstanding for Perth to then just being so underwhelming, where you thought, is Diego even playing today? It was weird. Chris Wandt, Aloisi has been given long enough.
You reckon he should be sacked? No, he's a bit early, man. Come on, you gotta give
bit
him
early.
I'd say give him at least.
Okay, but this all comes back down to what are the expectations of the club. So when you look at the Backeries, I mean, they're a shambles as it is. Those owners probably should have never have been given that license in the first place when you consider their track record on their history. And it just seems to me like it's something that flares up. It's a big problem. Then the FFA get involved and the fans get involved and the club saying, oh, this is all a nightmare. And then it goes away briefly. It's gone away briefly now, but I feel like it's only a matter of time before it boils over again. I think JA actually recruited quite well in this off-season. They've got Adam Taggart. They've got a few players there that can actually cause some damage. They don't have a squad that's about 110 years old like they did last season. But the point is that under John, what have they managed to achieve? That's the question. So is this a club that expects to be finishing within the top six and playing finals football every year and that's good enough? Or are they wanting to push for either a grand final win? Or do they want to be playing in Asia? What are these clubs' ambitions? That's what I want to know.
Well, whatever their ambitions are, they have to reflect that in the way they set up their system. And I mean, not just their tactical system, but, you know, I think for ages, Brisbane Roar didn't even have a training ground. There were all those ownership issues. Luke Braddon left because his super wasn't being paid.
It was a shambles. Players weren't being played. Staff weren't being paid. And it was a disgrace.
And this is, you know, this is historically one of the best teams in the A-League ever. You know, under Ange, they were incredible. So
36 games undefeated. Stupid.
So for me, I think sometimes it's very hard for a lot of these. Yeah, we should be expecting more of the Raw right now.
But are they expecting more of the Raw? That's what I want to know. What do the Raw expect? Every season you come into this wanting to know, what is it that this club want to achieve?
Well, you know what? It would almost be good if the owners or, you know, the CEOs or whatever came out before the season and said, this is kind of what we are expecting. This is what we're aiming for. You know, you don't have to put too much pressure on the coach.
Yeah.
But you just make it clear, because sometimes
having that conversation with the coach. I just don't know that you know, the Backeries and everyone concerned there are having those conversations with them.
Yeah. Well, I don't think there'll be any decisions in the next couple
of weeks.
They're
just happy to pay the bare minimum and maybe cough up a bit of cash here or there where they need to, but then it's like business as usual, guys.
Yeah, which is why, let's not get into it, but why you should have promotion and relegation to ensure that no clubs get, you know, too relaxed and just go whatever.
I want it, you want it. Everyone via Facebook and Twitter wants it. I've been seeing so many comments about, we need a second division, we need this, we need promotion relegation. We need it, we want it, we don't have it. Okay, what are we going to do in the meantime? That's my thing. We keep talking about the things that we don't have in this league. And I understand it, because we want to see the league improve. We want to see the interest return. We want to see it grow.
Yeah.
But in the absence of all of this, because I truly believe that we're still not ready for that. I don't think that we have the infrastructure in place within the A-League and as well as the second division and state league level. I still think we're a ways off from that. What are we going to do with the existing product to give it the love and attention and affection that it needs? And I still feel like we haven't given it enough.
Yes, that's true. And I tell you what we need to do, even if there is ever a second division, but we need to make sure that all Australian football games, A-League, second division, whatever, are at football-specific stadiums.
Oh, I agree, because how freaking epic was that FFA Cup final?
Exactly.
Oh, my gosh, the atmosphere, those Adelaide fans. Exactly. I was watching it on TV. I had goosebumps. I was like, this. I was more enthralled with the atmosphere and everything going on there, similar to what we had when we've been covering the Copa Libertadores games, when we did Boca at La Bombonera. I mean, that's just crazy. You're enamoured with everything going on around you. It's intoxicating.
Yeah.
And if only we could recreate that on a more regular and consistent basis, Stolich, this would be a different league. But you can't...
It makes a huge difference.
You can't just fabricate that. You can't just say to fans who have been disenchanted with the quality of the league for so long, with ticket prices, with everything and the treatment of the fans and the active support, you can't just say to them, oh, come on back to the games now, come on, the football's on. Well, you pissed a lot of people off in the meantime. Yeah. So what are you going to do to make them happy again? This is my whole point.
And that FFA Cup final, I think, was a great example of exactly what Australian football should be aiming for every week, which is a packed, small stadium, a rectangular stadium, so the fans are almost on top of the pitch. There's a huge atmosphere. You know, I've seen a lot of A-League players say, yeah, it's one of the more intimidating atmospheres.
Yeah.
You go down there, you know, people speak very highly. I think, and everyone watching that game on TV, and everyone at the stadium would be like, yeah, I want to watch more of this. This was great skill from Craig Goodwin with the two finishes, drama. You know, you had it all. And you also had no VAR, which was kind of interesting.
No VAR. I mean, that's kind of what I've been arguing for this whole time now. It's not the technology, it's the people implementing it. And if we don't have the people that are good enough to implement it, then get rid of it.
You know,
that's like giving me a lawnmower and going, make it work, or a whippersnipper. For starters, I wouldn't even know how to turn either of them on. I'm just going to be completely honest about that. Or someone opening the hood of a car and going, all right, Lucy, we need you to get in there and just tinker with a few of the mechanics and fix up the car for us. I can't do it. I'm incapable. I'm admitting I'm incapable, so I'm not going to try.
Mm.
Right? We've tried. It's not working. Let's get rid of it and leave it to the people that know how to use it.
Well, we didn't have any VAR controversy this week, but did you see Chris Beef, who was obviously at the centre of it last week, when Costa Barbarossa's goal was ruled offside and he knew he had to go to the VAR? Oof, he looked nervous.
He shit himself.
He was going like this.
He did.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so he's offside. Definitely offside. Oh, thank God it's offside.
Yep.
Okay. No, we don't need to go. We don't need to go.
No. It's fine now.
So,
it's fine.
Yeah, we see. But you know what? As we said before, maybe Mane's goal would have counted for Liverpool, Arsenal. So, you know, two sides of the coin.
Two sides of the coin. Which side of the coin do you like the most?
I like the VAR when used properly and effectively. But if it can't be used properly and effectively, like you say, then, you know, don't give the kid the whippersnipper.
I agree.
Just going to cut off his toes.
I'm that kid. I'm just going to trash the whole place.
Yeah.
In fact, I'd probably end up giving myself a fancy haircut, much to your pleasure.
Yeah. So send in your power tools for Lucy to get for her birthday, and she will,
Friday, by the way.
Yeah. Happy birthday.
Thank you. Can we please talk about the talk of the town as we wrap up the show? I know our producers have wanted us to go about half an hour ago, but this I feel like we have to talk about because this is big news. We've done the Prem, we've done the A-League, we've done some talking points going on at the moment, but this one's huge.
Mm.
What do you think about this whole theory of this Super League, this 20-league team competition with all the top teams from around the world amalgamated into one 20-year licenses, so no relegation for at least 20 years? I mean, this is, it's crazy. I tried to get my head around the concept in the first place and I was like, wow.
Yeah.
Wouldn't this be thrilling? Wouldn't this be exciting in terms of a quality perspective? But naturally, UEFA have kicked up a big stink about it. FIFA, what do we think?
So on the one hand, wherever the best players play, you're always going to want to watch.
That's true.
You know, as much as everyone complains and all this kind of thing, they don't want this, where the best players are, we are going to watch because we like good football and we want to see the absolute best, the absolute great. You know, as much as people sometimes get upset about a World Cup before it starts, like everyone watches Champions League finals, but no relegation for 20 years, I think, is a shocking idea. And I think it's going to kill off a lot of like smaller mid-table clubs. And I think, you know, there's really... I think it would be a really bad thing done. But all these clubs want to do is make more money. That's all they want to do.
So this is just a good money-making scheme, you
and
feel? Because that's what a lot of the reactions have been. A lot of people saying it's just greed.
Yeah.
It's just them wanting to fill their pockets even more so.
But you know what? These are often private companies.
Yeah.
Well, these are traded on the share market. So they have an obligation to their shareholders, which is exactly why that no club should ever be on the share market and should be just owned by the fans. because they need to, well, you need to make more money. So they're always going to be pushing for things like mm-hmm. this, and they're not going to stop. They're not going to stop at any, so they're going to find every single way that they can to squeeze out more money, whether it be Super Leagues, bigger Club World Cups, Barca playing a game in the USA, all this kind of stuff, more pre-season tours.
Yep.
It's all going to happen, and the only way you can stop it is if you make sure that these clubs aren't private companies that exist to make money. In fact, they are football clubs for the community that they represent.
Very good point, Stolich. Yeah. I like it. You've hit the nail on the head there. Some people saying they like it, some people saying they don't. Alex Kosovsky, feeding into what you're saying via Facebook, it's a super way to make money.
Yeah.
Santino Mamone, Juve is on the stock exchange.
Yeah.
That's, you know, again. But if you are saying that you like it, I want to know why you like it. If you're saying you don't like it, is it because of the reasons that Stolich has referenced? I'm seeing a lot of mixed reactions, but I'd like to know what your thoughts are before we wrap up the program. Yay or nay, and if you are in either camp, why is it that you're for it or against it? It'd be interesting to see. But the W League also, it's been fantastic to see them in full action. Of course, I being a Canberra United fan, I'm very happy that we are sitting pretty on top of the table at the moment. Of course, it's still his only early days. Two matches have been played. But Melbourne City, they're looking strong once again this season.
I saw the grand final
replay between Sydney FC and Melbourne City, which was great. I think it did live up to the hype.
Yeah.
But they've said coming into this season that it was going to be a more competitive season because, quite frankly, great success achieved by Melbourne City, but we want the league to be more competitive. We don't want to see them toweling it up every season and comfortably as well. So I dare say, as it stands so far, it's shaping up to be that way, Stolich.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, you saw Perth v Canberra, 4-4, an incredible game. Sam Kerr was involved in three goals, which is great to see going into the Matildas game, which, of course, on SBS against Chile, I think this Saturday and next Tuesday. It was a great weekend of W League. There was that goal, that sensational goal from like 30 metres out or something for the victory. I think it was, Melina Ayres.
Yes.
Amazing strike.
Stupid.
If you haven't seen it, go to our website. We've got
it
there.
Stupid.
Incredible goal.
Wonder goal.
I think there is some bad news that Kai Simon will miss the Matildas games, which is a shame.
Yep.
So, you know, she's... an amazing player for the Matildas, so unfortunately she won't be there. But
I agree, but then it gives an opportunity to another player to step into that role, and I think leading into this Women's World Cup cycle, I think it's important for us to be able to get a look at the other players that we do have on offer. But that's, you know, opened up a big conversation around, you know, are we letting these youngsters debut in the national team, and the fact that we don't have, you've got 15-year-olds. But see, Sam Kerr's a perfect example. She was 15 when she made her debut for the Matildas, and look at how far she's come.
Yeah.
But what the conversation has opened up, and this comes from players that have been involved in the game. We had Joey Peters and Catherine Cannulli in here talking with us, and they will be back again this week, which is great because their insight and analysis is fantastic. Both are coaches and both plying their trade respectively at Northern New South Wales. And then we've also got Catherine Cannulli at the Wanderers. But they both say that, you know what, we need to have better development ranks at that under sort of 20s, under 17s level for the Young Matildas. Young Matildas, of course, is a program that Coach Alan Stajcic, head coach of the Matildas, has created, which is really important. But there need to be better pathways for these younger players to be coming through, that so that we're not throwing them straight into the deep end to see what they're made of within the Matildas side. So again, all very interesting talking points, and I'm sure that we'll touch on more of those. But it is a massive week coming up in football. It's going to be huge for us.
Yeah,
it's going to be huge
massive,
for me. I've got a big schedule on Saturday because we are covering the Matildas taking on Chile. That's live from 3 p.m. Australian Eastern Daylight Time on SBS. So we're looking very forward to that. And reasonable time, guys. So it's going to be possible for you to tune in. Then after that, from 11 p.m. in the East, so later that night, we go back to the Premier League for the match between Cardiff City and Brighton and Hove Albion. We'll be good to see our very own Matty Ryan in action too, so tune into that from 11 p.m. on SBS. Then in the wee early hours of Sunday morning, live from 5:30 a.m., we are bringing you the first leg of the Copa Libertadores final. Oh my God, coming to you from La Bombonera. This stadium is one of the most iconic in the world. This fixture is one of the most iconic in the world. The Super Classic, for the first time in 54 years, we are seeing two of the greatest rivals in football go head to head in a Copa Libertadores final. This is history being made, right? Because next year, Stolich, we're not going to see this because they're reverting to a one-game final. So it's also going to then be played on neutral territory. Man, history is being made, and we get to witness it.
If you are, if you call yourself a football fan and you don't watch these two games, you can't call yourself a football fan. This is the absolute one of the biggest games in the history of football. This will go down. This will be talked about for years and years and years.
And we get to witness it.
And we get to witness it live,
free, in HD. I will
recant
this to my offspring when he or she is born. 100%. I can't wait. That's what I'm looking forward to.
We cannot exaggerate how big and how intense this game is going to be. Two of the biggest rivals in the world.
The Super Classico.
Iconic clubs. Maybe the most fierce rivalry in terms of the way the fans
interact. It's ugly.
Yeah, it's crazy. You know, a few years ago, Boca fans pepper sprayed at the river tunnel that they were running out. Like, it's absolutely mental.
But I do understand that the river fans won't actually be able to attend. Is that correct?
I believe that they're given 4,000 away tickets because in Argentina, no away fans are allowed to attend opposition games because of the history of violence and all kinds of issues. But the Copa Lib doesn't have those rules, and under Copa Lib rules, their away fans have to be given tickets.
Okay.
And you know, a game as big as this, you know for sure that they're going to be sneaking in anyway. So, listen.
It's going to be huge.
Fireworks on the field, fireworks off the field. You have to watch this one.
Talking about have to watch, this, I promise this will be our very last thing because I've had a few people question us about Champions League.
Yeah.
That is on this week and some decent fixtures coming up too. Of course, Red Star Belgrade, Miloš Deganek's side at home to Liverpool. We saw what happened in the first leg at Anfield. This is going to be interesting on this one. I find that it's going to be a mountain too big to climb.
Should be a good atmosphere.
Crvena Zvezda. Should be a great atmosphere. We know that Red Star Belgrade's fans are fantastic. They put on quite the show. Very passionate supporters. Then you've got Monaco at home to Club Bruges. Atletico taking on Dortmund. Dortmund on fire at the moment.
Yeah.
Tottenham, right, they are back at Wembley after what happened between PSV Eindhoven away. So that'll be a very important game for them because their Champions League hopes are hanging by a thread. Napoli taking on PSG. My. But then you've also got Man United away in Turin to Juve. That's going to be huge as well.
I mean, United, what are they on? They're on 4 points. They were terrible against Juve in the first leg,
that was,
I guess,
such a bad performance.
Yeah,
that was really, really bad.
And to be honest, I'm not expecting much better. So, you know, United could be in a bit of trouble if Valencia get their act together and really kind of give young boys a bit of a
pasting. Young boys are always the whipping
the whipping boy
of the group. Boys, plural.
Yeah, exactly.
But, you know, in Group H, you've got Juve and Man United in the top two positions. Group G, you've got Real Madrid and Roma. And then following behind, CSKA Moscow and Pilsen.
Yeah.
But then in Group F, Manchester City on top there, a point ahead of Lyon. Then you've got Hoffenheim and then Shakhtar at the bottom two. Group E, Ajax, Bayern, Benfica,
Ajax. Go on, Ajax.
Go on, Ajax. Wouldn't that be fascinating if they would have won that group?
Yeah, of course, because you know what, Ajax is a historical club and you've always got to respect, I mean, not that Bayern and Benfica aren't, but
still,
you know, so much of all we know about modern football comes from the great Ajax team of the 70s and all the amazing players that they've developed, so I always love to see them.
Yeah,
I think they've got an iconic
let's not
kit.
let's not live in the past because that football that football's dead now, baby. I'm telling you,
Frankie de Jong, who plays for Ajax, is one of the most amazing players you ever see. He's like a centre back who can dribble like Messi. Like, it's incredible.
A marauding centre-back.
Yeah, no. It's incredible.
Group D. Porto and Schalke in the top two. Then you've got Galatasaray and Lokomotiv Moscow.
Yeah.
Then you've got Group C. Liverpool, Napoli, PSG, Red Star Belgrade. Red Star Belgrade, of course, we don't expect to progress.
No.
But then Liverpool are on top on 6 points. Napoli, 5. PSG, 4.
Are PSG going
to get out of that group?
I mean,
imagine they don't get out of the group.
If they don't get a result in Napoli, it's going to be very hard for them. So
what's going to happen to Thomas Tuchel then?
What's going to happen to Neymar?
Let me tell you now, that is a club that's like, you just don't want to touch it. If I'm a coach and I'm a decent coach, if that position was to be offered to me, I'm not touching it.
PSG, if they get knocked out in the Champions League, will just buy UEFA.
Tuchel will be sacked.
They'll buy UEFA, they'll create a new European Super League and they will give themselves a 50-point head
start. I'm telling you now, Tuchel's going to be sacked. That's the same reason why Emery was sacked. He won the league, but he didn't win the Champos.
And then Tuchel will go to another club and do well. So PSG might be the problem.
Who knows? Group B, Barcelona, Inter Milan, Tottenham, PSV, Eindhoven. Tottenham, they're not getting out. They're on 1 point. That group, to me, has already sort of been decided.
I reckon. Well, okay, here's the thing. If Barca beat Inter, Inter stay on 6, and then obviously Tottenham will need to beat PSV. So Tottenham are at home. Go to 4 points, 4 of V6. Then Inter have to go to Wembley. or wherever the hell Tottenham are going to play their remaining games.
I don't give any hope to Tottenham in the Champos. I give them
a slight 20% hope.
A cough?
Yeah. A little bit of, you know, if it's a honeymoon thing, it's like the last day, but maybe you might just get lucky.
The lingerie shop's closed. No negligees for Tottenham.
Use your imagination. Go on, Tottenham. You can do it, Pochettino. You don't have much of a budget, but
use
you know.
Use your imagination. Group A. Stop talking before I get myself in more trouble. Dortmund on 9 points. Atletico Madrid in second place on 6. And you got Monaco and Club Bruges dead last, both on a point each.
Yep. Thierry Henry should probably come on the field and play for Monaco at the moment.
Should he?
They need his help, I think.
Everybody could do with a bit more of Thierry Henry, let's be honest.
Yep.
I think we've probably had to do enough with each other for today because it's 4 o'clock.
It's four o'clock.
We are gibbering.
Someone
for
get the accounts.
Fun. Well, we got the wind up half an hour ago, so it's really only our fault. Hassan Bertan via Facebook. Sorry, Liverpool, no chance. Be quiet. Don't you be talking about my Liverpool like that. Santino Mamona, Inter, no chance.
Yeah, they're pretty not no chance. They're ahead of Tottenham. Man, what's with all this no chance, honeymoon, go
Christopher
over?
Martin.
You guys are nuts.
Christopher Martin, no lingerie, just Spurs.
Just Spurs. Yeah. All right. Is that an image? I don't know what's going on with that.
I don't know.
I want to get that out of my head.
I don't think it's an image. I think there's the honeymoon period is over. That is the person that's left. It's just Spurs and that's it. And you've tried everything. You've tried the negligee. You've tried the candles. It's nuts.
Yeah.
Can't be fixed.
I think Pat might be coming to switch off the lights. It's just I don't know what's going on, Facebookers, but we'll get it. Hey, there's camera angles changing. It's dynamic.
Gosh.
It's all starting.
Santino Mamone, Lucy, what's your cooking tonight? I'm not cooking anything, actually. I've had a big few days. I need to relax. Corey and I are going out for dinner. Leave me alone.
Come on, man. If she's on the bus, make sure you stand
up
for
her. Can I just ask anybody out there before we get, you know, we wrap this up finally. If anyone lives on the Central Coast, please, tell me where to eat, okay? Because we're finding it a little
Sydney.
Bit difficult.
Yeah.
I miss Sydney for the cuisine. Corey and I love this Italian joint here. It's great, but we cannot replicate it in the Central Coast. And it's lovely, relaxed living out there, but I need somewhere to eat. I need a night off.
Another thing. Send through your random, the more random the better, jerseys. We need more jerseys to wear. We need different.
Do you know which jersey I'd love to get my hands on? Yeah. A Boca jersey.
Yeah, well, you know what?
But an old school Boca jersey.
We will work on a Boca, one of us wearing a River, one of us wearing a Boca jersey for next week. So if you have them, if you have old ones, whatever, send them. We'll wash them, we'll send them back to you. Don't worry, it's not going anywhere.
Oh, yeah, I'll pay for it to go to dry cleaning, but I want an old school Boca jersey. So I'd love someone to be able to find one for me.
Yeah, Boca jerseys, River jersey, send them through, or any even your random club team jersey, I don't mind, but we'd like to have a few more jerseys to decorate as well as wear. So
I agree, but in the meantime, if you're struggling for that, do head to Football Cult, because they have been providing us with some sensational gear at the moment. I love this shirt, love that shirt.
That's
all the stuff
shirt
that Anthony Siakos is designing and providing has been epic. It's been epic having your company too via Facebook and Twitter. I don't know what's occurring here, and it's probably their own subtle way of saying, right, we need to get rid of you. You need to stop. So we're going to stop now. Thank you guys for writing in with your questions and your comments via Facebook and Twitter. Like I said, plenty more football action coming up this weekend. Stop toying with the furniture. If you need telecast details, head to the World Game website or check out the SBS television guide. But for all the stories that we have discussed, do head to the World Game website. We've got opinion pieces. We've got all the news that you need to know. Some great videos doing the rounds, so make sure that you check it out. But in the meantime, we're going to figure out which ghost is operating the camera. I'm going to go home and get some rest and just... enjoy the week that will be.
100%. Tune in, SBS is the best.
Ciao. Das vidanya, guys. We'll see you next Monday.
Bye.